I'm going to ask some questions, and I really want you to let me know how you feel about the questions by either raising your hand or if it's a verbal response I'm looking for. Don't be shy and tell me the truth when I ask the question, because I really want to know. And if they've done this when I wasn't in the room, I apologize, but let's do it again because I missed it. Now, I know all of you guys are here to learn about long range shooting.
Woo! Yeah!
Okay, got that right. Now, how many of you are going to apply what you learned this weekend to hunting, exclusively hunting, and that's what you are? You're a hunter, and you want to know how to increase your opportunities by being able to stretch the limits of what you feel comfortable shooting.
Not
exclusively,
yeah. Yeah.
Well,
you know. Yeah. Okay. I understand. He says not exclusively. All of us, even if we're hunters, we still like going to the range and shooting and seeing what our rifles will do and trying to push ourselves. But you're going to use it in a hunting situation more than anything else. Okay. Well, that's 1 out of 21. Who's going to be using this in competition as a competitor?
Yep.
Okay. What kind of competition?
I'd like to jump into the full PRS.
Okay.
So
okay.
Long distance.
Well, that's a great guy to talk to.
I know.
So that's 2 out of 21. So we've got 19 guys here that are not hunters and that are not going to compete.
Liberty Preservation.
So that, well, you know, that makes us feel real good when we say that. But to be perfectly honest, you guys are in here because you want to learn more about long-range shooting because you love it. And you're excited about it, and it's kind of new. You push the boundaries, you get to learn new things, and it keeps us young. Because they've already proven that all we have to do to stay young is to continue to learn. They found out that for people in their 80s, the best way to stave off old age is to dance. And the reason it is because they have to learn new steps, learn new things, and continually think, and it works with their body too. Well, so that's what we're doing. We're trying to stave off old age by learning to shoot first. Okay. That kind of goes along with preservation, right? So we're going to talk a little bit about hunting right now here at the first. And Rex made some really good points about choosing the equipment that really fits what you're going to do. And I may have a different perspective about how to accomplish what it is that you want to do, or any of you if you happen to be hunting. But I'm going to give you some options. One thing I do want to say now that I'm thinking about it is on these rifles that they mentioned being really good options for accurate rifles to start on in the quality firearms in a price range that's affordable. The Tika T3, the Savages, the Bruguera. We make stocks for all those. And that's usually the first thing somebody decides, well, I'm gonna upgrade my rifle, I'm gonna take that next step, and they start looking at stocks. So one of the things that we're really proud of is we have a really large selection of stocks for almost everything out there. And that gives you an opportunity to be able to buy a Savage 110 or maybe pick up a used Savage from 7 or 8 years ago. They've changed consistently. One thing about Savage that we struggle with is about every 2 or 3 years, they change a little something on their action, which means we have to know what that is when we're inlaying for it, because when the customer says, well, I got a 112. Okay, is it the old one with the guard screw that's 3 3/4 inches, or is it the new one with the 5 1/4 inch guard screw? Oh, I don't know, measure, okay. So we have to be able to know what it is in order to make the stocks for them exactly what they need. So let's get to hunting. This is what most would consider a semi traditional type hunting stock, but it's not really. It's really not. A traditional hunting stock usually had 3/8 to 1/2 inch of drop at the comb, had a more slanted pistol grip. You know, when everybody started to learn to shoot, it was hold the elbow out. And that's the way that we were taught when we were kids. But, you know, now if you watch a high power silhouette match where they're shooting offhand at pig size animals at 600 yards, you know, they're sitting like this, as close and tight as they can. And so now all of a sudden, the equipment that we use has changed a little bit for the way that we shoot. Scopes are bigger. 40 millimeter objective lens scopes were pretty commonplace until about 1995, when they started putting bigger light gathering capabilities into scopes, so that the higher, the bigger the objective lens, the more light gathering. So not uncommon to find 50 and 56 millimeter objective lens on scopes. And what that means is, because that's sitting right over the chamber of the barrel, which is the very biggest part of the barrel, is that you have to set the scopes up higher so that you don't set the scope on the barrel. That means you're, instead of low rings, now you've got medium rings or even high rings in order to be able to clear the barrel. And what that means is that for a comb on a stock to allow you to put your cheek on it and see through the scope, it's got to be much higher. Well, one of the restrictions that we run into is that to put a scope as high, I mean a cheek piece or a comb as high as we need it on a fixed comb, it's a real problem, because we have this little thing that you got to pull back here and to cycle around in it called a bolt. And the bore line is at a certain height, and there's no way that we can get around that. So this particular stock is designed absolutely as high, the comb is as high as we possibly get, and still cycle the bolt on a standard ring spin type round action. Now, some have bigger cocking pieces, some have smaller, but this, as a general rule, is the highest comb we can have. So now you can get behind the scope, get a cheap weld, and still see through the scope when you've got medium or high rings on it. So that's one of the changes we made. Also, this is what we call a vertical pistol grip. Now, yes, it is not exactly 100% 90 degrees to the bore line, but it's really close. And the reason that we've done that is because as the ranges get farther and farther, more and more shots are taken from the prone position. And we're talking strictly about hunting now. So in order to be able to lay on the ground, relax, get your hand in the right position, have your trigger to pull the trigger straight towards the rear, which is optimal, having a pistol grip which is vertical like that makes it much, much easier to do it, rather than a pistol grip that is really designed for you to hold like this, as the old ones are. So now all of a sudden we've taken everything that we've learned from all the tactical experience that we've had, we put it into a hunting stock, and as a result, this stock right here, this is the game warden. It has an adjustable cheek piece because we felt like we designed the stock, we found out, oh, the comb's a little low and we're having a little bit of trouble. We went ahead and devised an adjustable cheek piece. Now, yes, this is not a typical hunting stock. You can have issues with dragging the screw on and getting things in the cheek piece, and those are things you like to avoid. But the fact of the matter is that if you had an option of being able to get on the scope with a cheek weld that's comfortable, that allows you to absolutely shoot as well as you can, you'd figure out how to avoid all those problems that you have with the adjustable cheek piece and you'd choose it. Now, that also adds about 6 ounces to this stock. This stock right here weighs about 2 pounds, 6 ounces. So a standard game warden, and we have two stocks, game scout, game warden. The only difference is game scout, smaller barrel, up to a number 3. Game warden would take up to a number 8. You need to put a MTU in here. So, but these stocks are designed specifically for hunting, but they're specifically to be everything you could possibly need. This is an A3-5. Very common to see hunting rifles built on this stock. The forend is fairly thin and straight for a tactical stock. This was originally designed for the Norm Chandler came to me and said, "Hey, we like the buttstock of the A5, we like the hook, but we weren't thin. Can you put the A3 on the A5?" We said, "Yeah, well, we can do that." And they did it for the DARPA project. Is anybody X10, X15? I don't know, whatever it was. What I thought one of you military guys would know that, but.
Yeah, we had the X1 and 2,
but anyway, but this makes a really good hunting stock. You probably don't need the adjustable spacer system. You loosen two screws in the recoil pad, you take your spacer out, get the length of pull you want. But for all of you guys out there, how tall are you?
6'5".
6'5". How tall are you?
5'8".
How tall are you?
5'8".
Okay, 5'8", 6'5". That's about the spring. Every one of you can get this stock just like it is, adjust it to get to where you can get the perfect length of pull for you. Now, the nice thing about the spacer system, what you got to say in your exchange? Now, there are some people think that you need a longer length of pull for a prone shot than you do for offhand. But technically, whatever you're going to practice at, whatever you're going to do, you're going to get the length of pull, you're going to establish what's best for you, and you're going to fix it there, and you'll probably never change it again. But the spacer system allows everybody to be able to get this stock to fit them. Also, an adjustable cheekpiece, same reason we've got it on the Game Scout. But are any of you familiar with the television show Extreme Outer Limits? It's a hunting show. Yeah, you know, I don't know about you guys, but I don't watch a lot of outdoor TV. I'd rather be out doing it than watching it. And though I've hunted, I've got lots of these animals in my house and around my shop. But I don't really necessarily like to watch hunting shows. But my point was, Bob Beck, who is probably the foremost authority on long-range hunting of anybody you've ever known, if you want to watch somebody who knows how to get his gun to perform to where he wants it to, and he's comfortable killing animals at and beyond 1,000 yards, and what we call ethically, and meaning that one shot kills where the animal goes down, and he has never, in the 9.5 years he's been filming his TV show, has never lost an animal, and I know that because I provided all of the guns for his show up until the time I sold my rifle company, and
His wife does.
Yeah. And he's pretty good. He's about 6'2". He's about my size. So if you want to watch somebody who shoots animals at a long range and really talks about it, he asked me if I would sponsor a show, and I told him, "No, I'm not into it." He said, "What do you mean you're not into it?" I said, "I really don't believe it." He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, you know, I just don't think that we can know enough about shooting 1,000 yards to be able to shoot animals at it and affect a humane kill." And he said, "Well, what if I change your mind? What if I showed you what can be done?" And I said, "Okay, show me." So we spent a lot of time together, and I decided to support his show by advertising on his private rifles. But I told him, I said, "Bob, you gotta show him this." He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, you have to show the guys, you gotta put it on TV when you miss a shot." He said, "Well, why would I wanna miss?" I said, "No, I don't want you to miss on purpose." I said, "But if you do, and when you do, you gotta put it on the show, because otherwise they'll believe you just edited out all the bad stuff and just show the good stuff. But if you show them that you miss, and then you use that as a teaching opportunity, then they will believe that, like I do, that this can be done in a way that we can all get behind." So that's what he's done. He's done a great job. The show's great. He does a lot of teaching. Not only does he, when I stopped selling him rifles because I sold my rifle business, he said, "What do I do now?" I said, "Well, if I were you, I'd go into the rifle business." So he said, "Really? How would I do that?" And so I gave him an outline of how to get it done. And 9 months later, he produced his first MOA rifles. So there's another brand name of rifles that are extremely accurate, designed for shooting 1,000 yards. And if you want to look them up. And MOA rifles, very good quality stuff. I'm plugging a buddy, that's all I'm doing right now. Okay, so let's get back to fiberglass stocks. Do any of you own MacMillan fiberglass stock? Okay, one, two, three. Have any of you before today heard of MacMillan fiberglass stock? Okay, almost everybody. What is it about, and I'm asking for anyone to know, what is it about a fiberglass stock that has made you at least pay attention to who we are and what we do?
It's super solid, and then it's not affected by weather or temperature.
Okay. So we're looking for something that's going to give us consistent performance and is rugged and durable because we can depend on it under all circumstances. How many of you knew that we manufactured the stocks for the Marine Corps from 1975 to 2015? A few of you. That's good. Awesome. I think that's probably the best example of the durability of a MacMillan fiberglass stock. Every single one of our stocks have an unconditional lifetime guarantee. That means if for any reason it breaks, cracks, warps, splits, becomes unusable for any reason, send it back to us and I will either repair it or I will replace it, or if you insist, I'll give you your money back. And that's at any time for the life of the stock, regardless of whether you bought it off of eBay or you were the original owner. And the reason that I can do that is because I do that about twice a year. We make almost 13,000 stocks, 12,660 stocks last year, and sold that many. That we count the number of stocks that we've actually manufactured by the ones that we actually used to get out the door. So almost 13,000 stocks, and I replaced two stocks last year. One of them broke completely in half at the bolt match, and he said he just dropped it. Okay. I gave him another stock. Because he wanted another stock. I'm not really sure that's exactly how it broke, but I will tell you the three ways that most of the stocks that we have returned break. A horse rolls on it. Still a lot of guys hunting in the mountains and horses. And when the horse goes down and rolls out, it's in the scabbard. The only thing that's sticking up above the saddle is the butt stock. So this is probably the weakest area right here in the entire stock where the trigger slot is right next to the bolt notch, and that's usually where they burn. Same thing with ATV. We don't get that many anymore because almost everybody's hunting in a side-by-side instead of a quad. But when they used to be riding quads, they'd roll a quad over and it would do the same thing. And you might find this humorous, the third most often given reason for a broken stock. The guy leans it up against the back of his truck and forgets it's there and drives over with his truck. Now, it doesn't always break it when they drive over. It just depends on whether it's leaning up against something. But that's it. Now, I do have one other commonly used excuse on how their stock broke. And I'm honest about this, guys, serious. I put it in my vise, and when I went back to get it, it was cracked. I mean, I put it in my safe. I said, you know I'm going to give you a stock anyway, right? Oh, yeah, yeah. I said, then why don't you just tell me the truth? Tell me how it really cracked. Because I'd like to be able to make it the next time so that doesn't happen again. And he said, oh, no, really? I just put it in my safe, and when I went back, it was cracked. So if you ever have a MacMillan stock that fails, please be honest with me. We try to make them absolutely as good as we can so that you don't have to worry about having a hunt go bad, having a competition go bad, having stuff fall off of it when it shouldn't. So if you tell me the truth, then I'll be happy to try to make it better the next time. So I'm going to move on to competition. This has been the most successful competition stock we've ever made. You know how we designed this stock? This is called the exit, and I am really proud of the name, because in F-class, the whole intent is to shoot exits, which is the center part of the target. There's a 10 ring, and then the ring inside that with an exit. Now, if you're international, it's called a V ring, but we call it the exit because we're here in the United States and it's a major. This is shot off a bipod. So they basically lay down, they can use a rear bag, and they shoot off a bipod. What needs to be designed out of stock that you're shooting off a bipod? I mean, how could anything help you shoot any better? Well, what I didn't know until I started talking to the competitors is that how the gun recoils and where the scope ends up after the shot is as critical as anything in a competition stock. So they were using a prone stock of mine, which all of the sling shooters were using, that have a little bit of cast off, a little bit of cant, and the toe was on a pretty severe angle, and they would sit it in their rear bag, and every time the gun would recoil, the barrel would go off over here. They'd be the target over. And then they would have to push it back and make sure they're on their target and get it the same place. Now they could do that consistently, but it was hard work. So when we designed this, we put this heel on the same plane as the barrel. So now, every time it recoils straight back. Now, because of this, we took the cast off out of the buttstock on this, we didn't really want to bend it because it had some specific qualities to it. But if you look at this, it's really a little bit offset from this, but it doesn't matter. The bipod's gonna recoil back and the pad's over here a little bit and it recoils back. So the reason I came up with this stock is we sat down with 8 guys from the USA shooting team that was gonna represent the United States in the World FTR F-Class Championships. And this was in 2015. And this is the design that we came up with. So I gave the very first one I ever made to a guy named Derek Rogers, who went to a match with it and set a new national record that still stands, and won a national championship with it. I outfitted the USA shooting team with them, and every one of the guys shooting that stock said their scores went up, and they were able to win the 2017 World F-Class FTR Championships. So by putting together a stock that works for the shooters, we've been able to help everybody become better shooters. Now, we've had all kinds of talks about chassis and this, and Rex did an awesome job of talking about what you need to consider when you're considering what type of platform to put your barrel action into. This is our A5. Rex mentioned it. It's on his 338 Lapua. We designed this stock in 2003. I went on Sniper's Hide Forum. At that time, it was brand new, and there weren't a lot of forums out there that dealt with military-type applications and law enforcement, and it happened to be probably the best at that time for having real operators actually on the forum instead of wannabes. And I asked him, I said, what do you want to make the best tactical stock you can? So they gave me all kinds of, you know, put the Baker special forend on it, and we want adjustable cheeky vertical, but not too big, a little bit of a pump. So I had a list of about 15 things that they asked for. Well, I couldn't put them all into one stock because they were sometimes diametrically opposed, but we put the very best rendition of a stock that they asked for together, and we came up with the A5. Now, the A5 is the best selling stock we've ever made. It started very quickly after I sent the first 5 to the guys at Sniper Hide to give them a going over and a run through and to report back to the group to see how well they did. The good thing about that whole process is that they all took pride in the fact that they had some input into how this stock was designed, and they feel some ownership in it. So a lot of them bought it because they said, I helped design this. So. But we like getting feedback from shooters, and what it allows us to do is come up with better designs, better products. Now, the stock, is that an E2?
T4 folder.
If you want to see any of the other competitors that we have, their stocks, they have a version that looks just like this. And they say that imitation is a sincerest form of flattery, but I'm not really flattered. But there's no copyrights and there's no patents and there's no way to keep a guy. He could buy my stock, use it as a pattern, and make it, and you know, that's perfectly legal. And so most of my competitors have come up with stock because it is a really, really good tactical stock. McMillan's always been in the high end of the market. Even when we started, we didn't start out to be there. There was only us and Chet Brown. And Chet Brown used a process that was a little less time consuming and a little bit easier to do, and his prices came out a little bit less than ours. Anybody know Brown Precision, Chet Brown? He's from around these parts, been in the fiberglass stock business for over 40 years like we have. Nobody's heard of Brown Precision rifles. They're really good lightweight rifles. That's where they made their niche. They got out of the Ventress game, sold that off to Lee Six, who was a partner, and they stayed in the lightweight landing rifle stocks, and they came up with a stock in about 1990. They called the Pounder because it was really light, and they built real lightweight mountain rifle type guns. And they really have really done really well, really proud of them for finding a niche for their product and doing well. But you guys haven't heard of them because they do what they do, and it's for a small market, and they haven't worked very hard at making it available for everybody. Not everybody can afford a McMillan. I get two complaints, and I really get two complaints. Your stocks are too expensive. I can't afford them. And even if I could afford them, I'm not waiting 4 to 6 months. I can't wait too long. Can't wait too long. So I invite everybody who ever gets a chance to come to Phoenix, Arizona, that wants to come through our shop and take a tour. We'll give you about a 25-minute tour. Let you see everything that we do, from the inception of a mold all the way through the finished product and as we're shipping them out the door. And there's one reason why I really like to do that. Because when people come through my shop, they tell me at the end of the tour, I will never complain again. Now I understand why they're so expensive, and I understand why it takes so long. Because we put 8.5 hours of labor in every stock we make. They're all done by hand. Even though the inletting is done by CNC machines, every single stock is put in the fixture, the programs are matched to the order, and they're run. And they're inspected by a human after every stage along the way. So not too long ago, we were talking about, and I'm going to save this one to last. I know you guys are all excited about that. But
yeah.
I was talking about, we're just missing a part of the market. This stock right here costs, I think it's like $928. But you can get it exactly the way you want. If you've got a Surge in Action, you can order it for that. If you want an M5, a detachable box magazine, you can order for that. If you've got a Benchmark number 5 contour, you can order it for that. If you want 6 flush cups, 2 on each side and 2 on the bottom, you can order it for that. You can order it with 1 flush cup and a swing swivel stud in the back and a flush cup, in front and a flush cup in the back. However you need, if you wanted to, you could order it with this pinch block. But we have a thumb wheel adjustable cheek piece with a magnetic cheek piece on it. So in order to get your cleaning rod or your bolt out, you don't have to roll it down with your thumb, you can just take it off. So we have all those options, we give them to you and we let you do it. But some people say, well, I've got kids, I really want to make melon, but I really can't afford one. So we decided to come out with our MC3 size. So if you look at this and this, they're almost identical. Now the only thing that is different is this is a patented cheap comb riser, and it adjusts by loosening the screws, just like our spacer system on this one. You loosen the screws, you can take the spacer out of this, and you slide this up and down to where you want, and then you tighten the screws down, and it locks into place. So it's rigid, it's tough. I want you guys to take a break. When we take a break, I want you guys to come up here and handle all this stuff. I've seen them land over there, I haven't seen a single guy go pick up stuff. So I really want you to handle them just so you can see what we got. I don't want to feel like I came out here and wasted your time by talking for 30 minutes and you didn't really get a chance to look at the product. This product right here, with the exception of the rail on it, this rail I think is like $36, so if you add that to the price. This is $319. This one is $928, and this is $319. This is a never used before polymer. If you've ever seen a plastic stock, you've never seen one used and made out of this material. It's made using a process that no one has ever made. It has aluminum pillars molded in it, and these pillars are not just small aluminum pillars that fit. They're all an integral part of the molding process, so they're in there and rigid. What pillars are supposed to do is keep you from collapsing the stock when you tighten the guard screws. This stuff is so hard and so rigid, I'm absolutely certain you twist the heads off the screws before you collapse this material, but we put the aluminum in there because that's state of the art. That's what everybody wants. You know, a large percentage, here's one right here. They ordered, whoever ordered this stock when they ordered it and didn't take it, maybe it was because they can't. They ordered with molded in aluminum pillars. Well, this is solid glass actuary. The Marine Corps did a test. They went up to 300 pounds per square inch. And that's a lot more than the 45 to 60 inch pounds of torque on that, and they couldn't get any compression. So that means that it doesn't need aluminum pillars. But if it makes a guy comfortable and he thinks he needs it, we'll do that for him. But this stock right here comes in a fixed cone, fixed recoil pad, two swing swivel studs up front, and one in the rear. And this one in the rear, it's a flush cut, and this is an Uncle Mike stud adapter, but we're going to put it in the box with it, a flush cut swivel, so that you don't have to put the Uncle Mike stud adapter up. And this rail, we make it personally, it has a flush cut adapter in it, so if you have two flush cuts, you can attach your sling to it, and then when you take it off, the studs aren't in the way, especially here. Rex talked about the stud being in the way, the front stud. You have to worry about the rear stud too. No matter what you're shooting off, you should always have a rear support. There are about six companies out who make bags like this and like that and like that, all for rear rifle support. And because this is one of the most critical things to being consistent and having impacts where you want them down the line. So $259 for fixed cone. This is an area where you guys, if you just want to find out what it's like to take the plastic stock off the rifle that you've got and put something new on it, here's something that is in the price range where everybody can afford and they can feel confident that they've got the McMillan quality, McMillan service behind it. Okay, the last thing we talked about. I'm going to disagree with Rex just a little bit, and I'm going to say for the purposes of long-range shooting, everybody's idea is a little bit different about what that means. In F-class, mid-range is 600 yards. So they call that mid-range. They don't have a short range in F-class. Mid-range is 600 yards. Palma, which is long-range, is 800, 900, and 1,000. So they don't have any competitions that go out past 1,000. A lot of PRS stuff are adding 1,000-yard targets and beyond. I heard there was some crazy one that had about 1,600 yards on it last year.
They had a mile of the championship.
Yeah, so they're extending PRS S from long range to extreme long range. Now, ELR, you may have or may not have heard of it, but if you've been looking at anything on the internet that has to do with firearms, you've probably seen it. It has been determined by the group of people who want to compete in ELR that that means 1,500 yards or farther. And that's just a line in the sand to say this is long range and anything past 1,500 yards is ELR. Now, the King of 2 Mile is probably the most famous competition that they've had because they've had it for 3 years in a row. And there is no governing body over ELR, so they don't really have anyone to put on matches that has any type of consistency, but we're working on that. Now, I got involved in PR, in the ELR, simply because a friend of mine says, hey, part of the U.S. shooting team says, hey, we're going to go to King of 2 Mile. You want to sponsor us? Okay, well, I've never been to the King of 2 Mile. I said, okay, it'll be fun, come on. So I went to the match a little over 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago now, the second one that they had. And I noticed they were shooting my A5 Super Mag. It was the stock that we designed for the Chi-Tac, for the company Chi-Tac when it used to exist, and it was, you know, just starting out. So it looked just like this, but it was about 4 inches longer and a little bit beefier through the action because that Chi-Tac action is a little bit bigger. So we designed the stock for it, and people that are building, you know, 375 Chi-Tacs and 416s, they're building them on the bigger actions. A bat makes a 2.0, which is 2 inches in diameter and about 16 inches long, I think. But there are all kinds of custom actions that they're using for the big bolt face, large caliber stuff that they're using. So, but I said, you know, one guy, he had a 38 inch barrel with 2 inch chamber, you know, tapered down to about 1.25 inches, 38 inches. And I thought, man, you really need a really good solid platform when you're talking about a 40-pound gun on a bipod hanging out on the front end of a stock. That stock's, I mean, it's gonna have a big effect on whether that gun's gonna be able to shoot 2 miles or not. So I designed a stock, and so I called it the Beast. Now, it's not pretty. I mean, if I had to get in an alley fight, I probably wouldn't have this because I'd do some damage without getting busted up. But I did it specifically because of the reasons that we just talked about. Big, long, heavy barrels, 40-pound guns off a bipod, and the requirement that they need to be able to shoot consistently out to 2 miles. So I designed a stock that I thought would really help that. And came back to the King of 2 Mile in year number 3, and number 1 was won by Mitch Fitzpatrick. Year 2 was won by Vince Fitzpatrick shooting a Beast, and year 3 was won by Derek Rogers shooting a Beast, who became the first person ever to hit the target at 2 miles. Now, people say, oh, I do that all the time. Now, I shoot out to 2 miles, it's easy.
IR-15.
That's like the guy who gets the factory Remington or factory Savage to shoot a half-inch group with factory ammo. You know, I think we're all past that.
But he shoots at 3 miles.
Exactly. You know, if you've watched it all, check out the world record 3,600 yard shot. You know what that world record is? They pulled the trigger 39 times until they finally hit the target, and then they quit. They quit. I mean, I would think to myself, one out of 39 times, that's within the realm of luck or mistake. You know, if I couldn't hit it more than once. Anyway, so they claimed a world record because nobody else had said they'd ever done it before. the new organization that is being created, they're trying to set up a formula for which you can duplicate it and claim a legitimate world record. Now, I got one more thing I want to talk about. After the first year, I got to thinking, I said, you know, one of the things that everybody has trouble with ELR is seeing the bullet impact. Some guys were shooting 338s, but it was a big disadvantage because at 1,700 yards, they would miss the target. They couldn't see the bullet impact because it didn't make much of a splash. And some of these targets were hung off rocks. So seeing this target, the bullet splash was really important, and they just couldn't see it. 375s get a little bit better. 50 cals, they could see the splash, but they just don't have the ballistic coefficient in a 50 cal bullet to really be competitive at that range. So all of the 50 cals that competed, they usually got two or three rounds, and then they hit their limit. But I thought, well, geez, you know, it would be really good if a guy could see his own vapor trail and watch his own bullet. And have you all seen a vapor trail before? That's the coolest thing. I think that's really cool. I'm not very good at seeing it, but I've seen it a few times. But you're more likely to be able to see it from your own scope if the gun wasn't flying all over the place and you were trying to get back in the scope and get your field of view so you can see it. So I thought, well, what can we do to help manage the recoil, make the gun recoil straight back so the guy has more likelihood that even though it's a 7-second time of flight at 2 miles, once you've kind of lost sight of it, it's hard to pick it up again. If you don't catch it right off the muzzle, the chances of you picking up the vapor trail at some point in flight is very small. So what we want to do is let the guys be able to pull the trigger, watch the bullet go down range, and see the impact. And Rex made a point. He's smarter than he looks. He said most of the stocks have a little bit of drop from the bore line through the stock, and what that does is when the impulse comes back, because it's lower, it tends to want to lift the muzzle and you get muzzle jump, and that's what makes it really hard. So I looked at all of the stocks, that the Beast stocks that came with an adjustable three-way butt plate, and they all had their three-way butt plate up about an inch and a half to an inch and three quarters. That's so in the prone position they can get behind it, but still with those great big old huge scopes. And was that a TACCOM? And with those on, you've got even more clearance. So they're running the 34 millimeter 7x35 ATAC-Rs that have 120 minutes of MOA of elevation. And because at 2 miles, you need like 180. So if you ever want to shoot 2 miles, just figure out how you're going to get 280 minutes of elevation on your rifle, and then you at least have a chance. So what I've done is instead of putting a three-way adjustable butt plate on here, I moved this entire section of this stock up. And if you look at the recoil lug is the recoil impulse, is directly behind the lug. Everybody thinks about it being in the bore, and that's a good frame of reference, but really, it's not the gas coming out the end of the barrel. It's the pressure that's on the recoil lug that's trying to move this whole thing backwards. So what we've done is we ran a straight line through that recoil lug, and it comes out right in the center of the stock. Now the hole in the stock is so that you can put your cleaning rod through it and clean it properly. We wouldn't ever want you to clean it from the muzzle, but otherwise you'd have to take the barrel action out. And we decided that this is probably a better alternative for a lot of guys who are superstitious about taking their gun out of bed. Now, we've been making, the McMillan family's been making really accurate rifles since the early 60s. And we don't have a problem taking guns out of bed as often as you want to clean them. We've just never seen a bedding wear out. So if you have a problem with that, you can do everything you want without taking it out, and that's okay. But if you want to take it out, especially in one of our stocks, because I'm speaking specifically about that map. Don't be afraid to take it out of the barrel of action. All these guys who are building these guns that have to travel, they don't make a gun case that's 76 inches long. So they're having to take them apart to travel anyway, so it's not that big a deal. So anyway, the theory behind this stock, and we'll see, Derek Rogers has one. And I brought that name up twice. He won the King of 2 Mile, the only guy he could target at 2 miles. He was national champion in FTR, world individual champion in 2017 in FTR, and is the only man who's ever won a national championship in F-Class Open and F-Class FTR. And the only reason I bring that up is because that's a pretty good indication he's got to shoot. And it doesn't matter what he shoots, he can shoot. So I'm using him. Not in that sense, but he's agreed to help me out. He's going to test the stock. We'll let you know how that goes. But this is how we learn, and this is what we try to do to help further the sport. How many of these am I going to sell? Probably not nearly enough to pay for the mold and the developmental time. But we want to still give the people who are interested in the best they can be doing the things that they want to do and have fun doing it. Are we close? Okay, so we give everybody the opportunity to enjoy their sport as much as they can. One thing, once you start having all this stuff that allows you to be a little bit better and improve, and you see, you know, your distances and your groups shrink and you go farther, it makes you more excited about doing more. And you talk to your buddies about it and they get excited about it, and so the sport grows. So that's one of the main reasons why we get involved in competition. A very small percentage of our business is competition, maybe 5 to 7% of the stocks that we sell are competition stocks. But the fact is that that's where all of the technology is honed and how we learn about it. I want to read something to you, because we're talking about long range shooting. We've all agreed that 1,000 yards constitutes long range shooting. And I don't know if most of you guys have access to a range that's 1,000 yards, but if you don't, you probably have some place you can go out and shoot somewhere near that, because that's why you're here. I was talking to a guy that I work with. His name is Alex Wheeler. Don't know if any of you have heard of him. He's very well known for building super accurate rifles in mid-range and long-range bench rest. And I would love to read this whole conversation with you. It happened this morning while I was out in the car waiting for the store to open. But what's important about the conversation is he designed a stock. I built it in fiberglass, and he's getting it in the hands of the best shooters in the world. And so he says, we're talking about a rudder. He puts a rudder on the rear of the stock. Instead of this just being, this is on a 5-degree plane so that you can slide it up and down on the bag and get minor adjustments in your sight picture. For open S-class, they like zero, because they run on a pedestal that's got so many adjustments on it. It's like bench rest on the ground, but they want that stock to track back and forth. They want to be able to put it on there, pull it back and forth 2 inches, and the crosshairs never leave the target, the X-ray at 1,000 yards. That's their goal. Hard to do that, even from a molding operation where every stock out of the mold is identical. You gotta get the first one right. So he puts a rudder on it so you can adjust that. And I was talking about this, I've tried to make an adjustment of 1,000 or 2 by hand. I mean, I've worked around machines my whole life. Have you ever tried to level something that had a pivot right in the middle, and you tap it on this end, and it goes there, and you tap it on it, and then finally you settle on something that's close enough, because you can never get that bubble right in the middle. Well, that's the way I felt about this keel, that adjustable keel that he has. And so I said, my better shooters are shooting 2-inch groups regularly at 1,000 yards. Oh yeah, I heard that before. 2-inch groups at 1,000 yards. I said, what's the record? And this is an IBS sanctioned event record. 1.3 inches for a five-shot group in the light gun category, and 2.8 inches for 10 shots in a heavy gun category. You know what my response was? Sounds impossible. It does. I've been around accurate rifles all of my life, and it sounds impossible that you could get a sub 2-inch group at 1,000 yards under any conditions, but they're shooting under 2 inches all the time. So we have made huge advances in all of the technology that Rex has been sharing with you today. I'm just here to testify that if you guys really get into this and you really want to get as good as you possibly can, you have a long ways to go. You really do. You've got a long ways to go. There's a lot of improvements you guys can make. And I know that's why you're here. You want to get better at what you're doing. So if you have a chance, get up here, handle the spots. If you have any questions for me, please ask them. There are no stupid questions. Manners makes a good stock. I take responsibility for him being in business because my delivery time was too long. And he got a lot of my customers by saying, I can deliver stocks in 6 weeks. Well, there was a time when that was true. Not so much anymore. He's about a year out now and stocks are more expensive than mine. But if you want to, he makes a good stock. But we're really proud of what we do. We have a great mind. We've got something for everybody. And if it comes down to the fact that you want to order a stock, I highly suggest everybody call the shop. We ask about 17 questions in order for us to get the information we need to make a stock properly for you and get you what you want. So don't think, I just don't want to talk on the phone or order it online, because we do have an online order form. But what happens when we get that order form is we go over it, and then we have to come back and ask you all these questions again, because we want to make darn sure we get it right when we make it. So take the time to give us a call. We've got an online catalog that's pretty awesome. If you didn't know it, I'm not really proud of this. I have an online radio show. It's not a podcast, it's a radio show, because it's broadcast live, noon on Fridays, Arizona time, California guys, during daylight savings time, it's noon in Phoenix. I mean, here at 11 o'clock in Phoenix. It's always 11 o'clock in California time. But you can hear it on voiceamerica.com, on the sports channel. I've got great guys, good guests like Rex and Phil Naiman, who is a guest. And we're going to have Seth on. What we do is we just talk about guns, we talk about products, we talk about somebody who has something really cool to offer in the industry. I give them half hour to talk about what their product is and what their business is and how they can share that with everybody. And it's really cool because you can go to my website, mcmillanusa.com, and click on the radio link, and then you can hear any of our radio broadcasts on demand, whichever ones you want to listen to. So it gives you a chance to be able to hear them on your terms, and you don't have to listen live. So if you want to have a chance to get some more information about the firearms industry, that's a great way to do it and kill an hour while you're driving if you want to. So appreciate your time, guys. Really glad to see all of you here.